Good morning. Welcome to this light breeze, cool Sunday morning as we're all worshiping together. A couple of announcements as we start. Do you have your communion cup? Have you gotten your little communion cup? If so, they're over there. Grab one so you're ready to go. We do have some little white buckets around, and those are wonderful for trash after because they're hard just to kind of hold on to. So communion cups. Also, we have paper copies of the link over there for you to grab if you do not have one in your email. But a way to stay in touch, please take a paper copy of the link. And we also have the bulletin over there as well. And on the back, you'll notice that our congregational meeting is next week after this service. So one thing, we are moving this service next week till 10. And I do believe we're going to keep it there to try to keep some of the heat down and so go as early as we can. So 10 is where we're moving to, and we'll stay there for a couple of weeks. Hopefully that's the right time to be at to just get ourselves out of here before it's really hot. So we have our next week 10 o'clock worship, then 11-ish meeting will start. So 10 worship, 11-ish meeting, it'll be out here. The live stream will be going of the meeting, but there's no way to vote or participate in the meeting via the live stream. So in order to participate in any of the votes, you have to be here. That's just the way that we have it. It's working right now in this new age. We also have Bible studies starting this week or going on this week. Pastor Paul, who's going to be doing our sabbatical time when Emily and I go on sabbatical next summer, he's going to be our pastor here. He's doing a C.S. Lewis Mere Christianity Bible study via Zoom on Monday evenings. The Zoom code is right there if you'd like to be a part of that. Our youth are doing their community nights. That's from college all the way down to middle school. They're worshiping outside. They're playing games outside. They're staying socially distanced, but just getting people together because people just long for community, as I know we all do. This is why we're here right now. Also, our blood drive is happening inside. They are full for their appointments right now, but it is a great gift. So that means we have 24 donors giving today. We've had as much as 33 donors giving when we were open on Wednesdays, all of April, during the beginning of the pandemic. So this church has really given a lot. And we've gotten, like 120 in April, and we've really been a participant in a lot of great blood drives. So giving blood is incredibly helpful. Also, the Red Cross is doing antibody tests on all the blood given, and you'll find out your results. So if you are curious about that, you can also do something good and get the benefit of having the antibody test as well. So a wonderful thing for us to do together. Okay, with those things being said, let us start our worship service with confession, knowing that God is always longing to forgive us, longing to hear our voices, but we need to just be honest with him that we are not as we should. We do not do the things we should. We miss the opportunities that we should, and we need to hear these words of forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us take a moment for silent confession. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, he loved us even when we were dead in sin. He made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. May Almighty God strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Let us stand and sing our opening hymn, Praise to the Lord the Almighty. You may be seated. At this time, I welcome forward Sandy Barron. She is going to do our readings today. So you can grab your bulletin and follow along with the readings there. And let us be blessed by the hearing of God's word spoken to us.
There it is. Destiny. Can you hear me? No. I could shout.
Well, hold on. That means it's not going to be live stream. Is it on?
Okay, just talk louder. All right. The first reading is from Isaiah 55. And all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress. Instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle. And it shall be to the Lord for a memorial, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. Our second reading is from Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through 11. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law and sin of death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and to deal with sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, so that the just requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death. But to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh. You are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit that dwells in you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks.
Check. Oh.
Let's stand. Let's stand for the reading of the gospel. Oh. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 13th chapter. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. And as for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And hears and immediately receives with joy. And such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among the thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke out the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word, understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, another 60, and another 30. The gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated. So the book of Ezra starts with that proclamation by the king of Persia to go back to the land. Then we have the kind of assembling of the going back to the land. And then we get to Ezra chapter 2. And if you looked at Ezra chapter 2 in your Bibles, you will notice a incredibly long list of names and numbers. These are the people who left. Here are their names. This is their family. This is how many people in their family. And it goes on and on and on. Now, when you're reading scripture and you're meditating, do you spend time just with lists of names? No, right? We tend to just go name, 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 and skip over it till the next section. There are a lot of sections of names in the book of Ezra and Nehemiah. So many so that we have to look at them and say, why are they there? Because they were writing in a time when there's only so much papyrus, right, to write down. Everything was handwritten. So if they were going to take the time to intentionally list these names, there had to be a reason they put that much time and space into a list of names. So let's just spend a moment thinking about the importance of names. The first thing is that if you've ever had to name a child, you understand how difficult it is to come up with a name. You realize that this name is going to last them their whole life. That this name, you know, will be the name you shout out when you're both happy and mad at them. That this name will be what they're called for forever. And you think, wow, there's this immense responsibility on naming our children. And so, as we get into names, we realize that names carry with it value and are important. As I said, Ezra 2 starts with this long list of names. Now, I'm going to read to you just two verses of the names to spare you having to deal with my pronunciation for names. Now, Ezra 2:1. Now, these are the people of the province who came up from the captivity of the exiles, whom Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, had taken captive to Babylon. They returned to Jerusalem and Judah, each to their own town, in company with Zerubbabel, Joshua, Nehemiah, Sariah, Reliah, Mordecai, Bilshan, Mispar, Bidva, Rehum, and Bana. Now, I'm going to read to you a section of scripture from Nehemiah 7. Listen. These are the people of the provinces who came up from the captivity of the exiles, whom Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, had taken captive. They returned to Jerusalem and Judah, each to his own town, in company with Zerubbabel, Joshua, Nehemiah, Azariah, Remiah, Nehemiah, Mordecai, Bilshan, Mispereth, Bidva, Nahum, and Bana. Same list. Ezra 2, Nehemiah 7. They even go so far as to list the exact same list. And in Nehemiah, they say, hey, look, we have this list of the first wave of people who came back. Let's read that list again. And they wrote it down again. So, why is that? Two reasons. The first is, is that this connects this whole story. This season, this Ezra-Nehemiah story that we're seeing together, these lists of names point to each other and help us to go see this as one big unit of the return of the exiles from captivity into the promised land to rebuild the temple, okay? So there's a literary purpose there. Now, in thinking about why Ezra and Nehemiah go on with names, the first thing is that names are important. As I mentioned, naming children has a lot of pressure to go with it. What's this person going to be called? But also, in the biblical times, people lived into their names. I mean, it's one thing I think that Emily and I hope for our children, naming them Grace and Hope and Isaac, is that this word being spoken of them over their life, that Grace and Hope and Isaac mean laughter, will be a part of who they are. That's a prayer that we have. One of the best stories for this name living into is the story of Jacob. Jacob was the grabber. That's what the name means, Jacob. And as the reason they named him that was on his way out, Esau and Jacob are twins, he's grabbing the heel of Esau. Then Jacob goes on for the rest of his life to live into this name. He grabbed away the birthright from his brother Esau. He grabbed away the blessing from his brother. His father-in-law tricked him and grabbed away the right woman he was supposed to marry. He had to work 7 more years for her. All of this is Jacob's name. He's the grabber. He's the one who gets things he's not supposed to get. Jacob ends up on a river going to see his brother Esau. And his brother Esau is the one who he stole away all of these things from, the birthright and the blessing. And now he has to see his brother. And the story picks up right there. That night, Jacob got up and took his 2 wives, his 2 female servants, his 11 sons, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent over all of his possessions. So Jacob was left alone. And a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip so that his hip was wrenched. And as he wrestled the man said, "Let me go, for it is daybreak." But Jacob replied, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." The man asked him, "What is your name?" "Jacob," he answered. I'm curious, how do you think he said his name at that point? He's wrestling with this angel who all scholars say this is Jesus here wrestling with him. And he's going all night. He's not giving up. He's about to see his brother whom he has betrayed. His name means grabber. When he asks him what his name, isn't that an incredible personal question? It's not just what's his name, but it's who are you? And Jacob goes, "I'm the grabber." Do you think he said, "Yes, I'm the grabber"? Or do you think he, after wrestling all night, went, "My name's grabber. I'm the one who gets the things I don't, not supposed to have"? And in that naming, I think is the truth of what all of us do to ourselves far too often. We take the names of the things that we have done and we put them on ourselves. We become the things that we do. I'm the liar. I'm the adulterer. I'm the cheat. I'm the lazy person. I'm the fill in the blank. And then don't we start to just live out those names over and over and over again? Those names don't just become things that we do, but they become who we are. And that's what I think is happening to Jacob here. Who am I? What's your name? I'm the grabber. Now, and this is a whole other sermon that we'll do at some point. It's so cool. But if this is Jesus here, isn't it amazing that Jesus lets himself get pinned? He lets himself wrestle all night long and loses. Seeing, right? You see, hear that? A man wrestled until daybreak. When he saw that he could not overpower him, Jesus looking to Jacob, going to not overpower. Forever, I've been wondering, why would Jesus not just overpower him? He's Jesus. And then I read the end of this book, and it said, we have a God who lets himself get pinned for us. That is exactly what he did on the cross. He let himself get pinned to the cross so that he could give us a new name. Rest of the story. The man asked him, what is your name? Jacob, he answered. Then the man said, your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel. Because you have struggled with God and with humans and have overcome. God lets himself get pinned so that we can get a new name. And what is our new name? Child of God. Beloved. Isn't it? It's mind-blowingly beautiful that Jesus went to the cross because he knows that we call ourselves all sorts of things all day long. We heap up shame and names on ourselves of things we've done, and he's going, I will let myself go to the cross, be pinned to the cross, so that I can be resurrected, so that you can give yourself a new name because of what I've done, child of God. I mean, to me, it's just that could go on and on. Let's realize the names we have in Christ and claim those names. Whenever you hear the whisper of the name you want to give yourself coming up, remember the cross and what Jesus did and say, because of your work, I'm going to call myself child of God, beloved, dear one, holy one. The importance of names. Names are important. The second reason, why is this list of names here? Because they could write it down. Not all of Israel returned back to the land. They stayed in Babylon. They stayed in Persia. Hey, we can write down who returned. It's hard work to go back to Israel to rebuild a temple and a city. I mean, look at what we're doing out here in worship, right? It's hard work to worship outside. Every week we set this up, we tear it down. We have this place inside there that's already set up all the time. But don't we take for granted what worship is when we're in there because we just push buttons, turn it on, and sit in the air conditioning? But for us to come here to do the work of that, these people came back into the promised land to rebuild the temple and to rebuild the walls. I found a great article that was talking about the names, and it's a Jewish article, and what they did was they looked at some of the scribes later on, and they said because the temple got destroyed again, the second temple got destroyed in the 77 AD, because that happened, they said the reason that that curse happened to the Israel people is because not everyone returned. There's an old like sage. This is what it says. If she be a wall, we will build upon her a turret of silver. If she be a door, we will enclose her with boards of cedar. Have you made yourself like a wall and had all come up in the days of Ezra, you would have been compared to silver, which no rottenness can ever affect. Now that you have come up like doors, you are like cedar wood, which rottenness prevails over. This is an early first century Jewish sage. Because you all didn't come up, we got the temple taken away again. We can list everyone who came up. We can list the ones who wanted to do the work. But I think there's something even cooler going on. This is the last reason that I think the names are here. I think if you compare, when you look at the building of the temple originally, the book there focuses on all of the individual items in the temple. Ezra and Nehemiah in the rebuilding of the temple doesn't focus on the items in the temple. What does it focus on? The people who built the temple. Listen to that same article. Additionally, this name list almost eclipses another feature conspicuously lacking attention in Ezra 1:6. While the book of Exodus, Leviticus, and Numbers go to great lengths in describing the construction and dedication of the tabernacle, Exodus 25:31, 35-40, Leviticus 8:10, Numbers 7, and the book of Kings allocates significant space to the first temple construction and dedication, 1 Kings 6-8, Ezra and Nehemiah offers only a three-verse description of the dedication of the second temple. Three verses, versus chapters and chapters. What does Ezra and Nehemiah do? Focuses on the people who came back. And that is exactly, I think, the point. God's shift is for us to move our eyes off of the temple and the land and onto the people who are doing the work together. That is what God wants for us to realize. Don't you know, 1 Corinthians 3:16, don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in your midst? Don't you know who you are? Don't you know your name? Don't you know that you are the ones who I'm going to do my work through, pouring out my Holy Spirit to this world? Don't you know that? It's not about buildings. It's not about places. It's not about land. It's about you being the people of God. 1 Corinthians 3:16. And the article ends this way. However, it should be clear that to the authors of Ezra and Nehemiah, these lists are an indispensable component of the storyline. Ezra and Nehemiah ultimately is not about as great leaders, buildings, or events as much as it is the story of a people trying to come to terms with rebuilding itself after the great catastrophe of the destruction of the first temple, constructing the temple and the city walls, and taking personal initiative and responsibility in revitalizing the spiritual character of a community that had reaccepted the Torah. Don't you know that this story is not about buildings, but about people? And that is the move I want us to reflect on today. God wants to work through his people to change the world. We love to focus on projects. We love to focus on building of buildings or creating new things, when what God wants us to focus on is investing in one another. Jesus says, store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moth and rust can't destroy and thieves can't break in and steal. Who is that? What is that? I think it's each other. Are we storing up our treasures by giving ourselves to one another, by giving ourselves to the poor, by giving ourselves to the hurting, by taking the time to sit and listen, really listen to people and where they are, and to tell them the good news that they have a new name, their name, child of God. Ezra and Nehemiah take the time to list names, not to list the items in the temple. And I think that's because it wants us to see each other. Because behind every name is a person and a story. So let's focus on each other. Let's focus on that truth. Instead of getting our eyes fixed on the doing, but let's be the people who are about the being together, gathering together, supporting each other, praying for each other. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for these people. Help us to focus on your work and your will. Help us to be a people who are about the coming together, who we know the temptation, I understand deeply the temptation, to want to be productive and get things done. But Lord, you have called us into focusing on names of each other. You've given us the time to sit and look at one another. So Lord, we ask that you work that in us, and you transform us to focus on those names and the stories behind the names. It's in your precious name we pray. Amen. Let us sing, Come Thou Fount.
Mountain. drink from the fold of God, here to rescue me from danger.
Together. Lord, I thank you that we get to experience a gift instead of having two services out here together, Lord. We get to come as one body. Lord, that we get to bring together different practices, different songs, different styles of music. That we get to learn from one another, see one another's faces, embrace one another during this time in our hearts and minds and how we worship. God, may we continue to unify. May the church continue to unify. Lord, I pray for areas that have been separated, that we would come together in the same way that you sacrificed yourself. You're willing to be pinned. Lord, may we be willing to sacrifice our preferences to come together for the sake of the other, to love one another. Lord, may we be a people that serve and sacrifice for the sake of love, to build up and bring together. In the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Let us profess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed in the bulletin in front of us. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. Let's take a moment to pray for our offering. Lord, we thank you for giving us gifts, and we thank you that you allow us to keep and use those gifts as we see fit. Lord, as we give back to you, let it be a sign of our worship. Let it be a sign of our trust that you are the God who has given us all, and you will always sustain us. In you, there is abundance. Where we see a lack, you see plenty. So, Lord, help us to grab onto that truth and to give generously because of your love for us. Amen. Amen. Let's take a moment now with our communion cups. That setting, that keyboard setting feels so like a revival church, doesn't it? It's like we just need people fainting, which may happen if we go long enough. Because it is hot. I'm sure glad the historical tradition is pastors wear black. It's really great. Really, really great. So, Jesus Christ comes to us through bread and wine. He gives us himself so that we can know that he is with us in, with, and under. And so it was the night he betrayed our Lord. Jesus took bread. And after giving thanks, he broke and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Amen. Please take the bread at this time. And so it was after supper to the cup. And after giving thanks, malt to drink, saying, this cup is new come into my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me. Please drink the juice at this time. As I mentioned, there are little white buckets around that we're using for our trash right now. You can put them in there. And let us pray this prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. And now may this, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Dear Holy Father, give you thanks for this gift of life through which you nourish and sustain us. Lord, allow this gift to send us forth in your peace, to bring light and love and hope to all the people that we meet. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let's stand and sing one of my new favorite songs, Raise a Hallelujah. And as I mentioned, we can have a revival here, so you all can just start dancing and passing out. Right? Let's sing.
All right.
love you so much, guys. Thanks for coming and enjoying this beautiful Sunday with us. Grab a drink, grab a snack, hang out for a little bit, and we'll see you guys next week.
Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.